हेलो फ्रेंड्स, ए वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल दी स्टूडेंट्स। एम आई ऑडिबल परफेक्टली? ओके फाइन। सो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, इन द लास्ट लेक्चर we had solved the different numericals that were given in practice related to the chapter of the properties of the gases. And friends, with that I had also informed you that from the next lecture onwards we are going to start one of the important chapter, that is unit 5, chapter number 5, that is the heat engines. Before starting the chapter, some of the students will be having the question, sir, why not you are starting chapter number 4 or the unit 4, that is properties of the steam? So dear students, just remember that properties of steam is a very complicated chapter and all the concepts are totally different. But I am starting the heat engines unit 5 because this chapter is again an important chapter, totally the analytical chapter. We need to understand several theoretical concepts as well as we will be making tremendous derivations of the different heat engine cycles. And for making the derivations, we will be using the concepts of the properties of the gases. So since you have studied the concepts of the properties of the gases and they are fresh in your minds, so if you are applying those concepts in the derivations of the heat engines, then you can perfectly understand the derivations of the different heat engine cycles. And also friends, this unit, that is the chapter of heat engines, one of the most important chapter considered the theoretical examination. So try to focus on the points which are covered in this session. And after the completion of the theoretical points, the analytical points, also we are going to solve the numericals in this chapter. So I hope now the picture is clear in your minds why I have skipped unit 4, properties of the steam, and directly now I am starting the unit 5, that is the heat engines. I hope the concept is clear to you. Kindly share your responses in the chat box. Okay, fine. Thank you all for your responses. So chapter number 5, that is the heat engines. So these are the main contents or the points which I am going to discuss in the current session. First, we will be understanding some of the basic concepts related to the heat engines. Then we will understand the different types of the heat engines. Then we will understand the comparison between the internal combustion engines and the external combustion engines. And finally, the last topic will be the elements of the heat engines. Dear students, before starting the discussion from my end, let me ask you one simple question. Where we have heard or studied the term that is heat engine? In which topic we have come across the term that is heat engine? Any student is remembering? In which topic we have studied the term that is heat engines? Okay, some students are answering thermodynamic process, some is telling Carnot cycle, thermodynamics, okay. turbines, geothermal station, thermal energy used by the prime movers. Okay, very good. So what the response is, some of the students are perfectly giving me the answer. So dear students, if you remember the classification of the prime movers that we have discussed in unit number 1 introduction. So in the classification of the prime movers, according to the energy used by the prime movers, they are divided into two types, the thermal prime movers and the non-thermal prime movers. In the thermal prime movers, the first parameter we have considered, that was the fuels. And in the fuels, if you remember, we have written the example, that was the heat engine. And again, the heat engines were divided into two types on the basis of the combustion of the fuel, that were the internal combustion engines and the external combustion engines. I hope you are remembering all those points which we have discussed previously. So let us proceed further in this session. So heat engine, as already told, it is a thermal prime mover. Another name, the heat engine can be considered as a thermal prime mover if we consider the technical approach to the heat engine. Then heat engine is basically a prime mover that is made to utilize the heat energy for the conversion into the mechanical work. And since the heat energy comes into picture, the thermal energy comes into picture, the heat engines are also known as the thermal prime movers. The heat engine, it involves a thermodynamic process that converts the heat supplied to it into the mechanical work. So this is the image showing the simple energy conversion taking place in the heat engines. So basically, friends, for operating the heat engines, the prime requirement is we must have the fuels. And in fuels, you are aware that all the fuels are having the chemical energy. The chemical energy is stored in the fuels. And all the fuels are having the CH bonds. They are the carbon hydrogen bonds, or all the fuels are the long chain of the carbon molecules. When the fuels are undergoing the process of combustion, I have intentionally taken a pause from my side because now I want to ask you a question. Dear students, which are the two prime requirements for the combustion of the fuel? Which are the two prime requirements for the combustion of the fuel? Try to think over it and then give me the answer. Some students have replied me in the chat box. Okay, some students are telling air and pressure. Some student is telling oxygen. Okay, what about the other students? Are you getting my question? What are the prime requirements for the combustion of any fuel? Hydrocarbon, okay, they are the hydrocarbon bonds. Very good. So I think the answer which I was searching for, that is given by rule number 67. Very good answer. So this answer I was searching for the combustion of any fuels, first we need to have the supply of oxygen. Oxygen must be compulsory available. And second, we need to have the igniting medium for the start of the combustion. Okay, if you want to see in the practical, you can take the example, collect the coal in the vessel, keep it in the atmospheric air. The coal will not undergo the combustion. The coal will only start the combustion when we are supplying some igniting medium. Then only the energy stored in the coal will be converted into the thermal energy. So on the combustion of the fuels, the thermal energy is generated, and this thermal energy is used in the heat engines. So thermal energy can be considered as the heat energy. So that is shown over here in the red color. And this thermal energy or the heat energy is further utilized to produce the mechanical energy. So finally, the output of the heat engine is the mechanical energy, or can be considered as the mechanical work. And as per the application, we can use this mechanical energy. In this image, we are showing that the mechanical energy or the mechanical work is further transferred to the generator. And in the generator, now we are producing the electricity. So finally, the mechanical energy is converted to the electrical energy. So basically, friends, the simple definition of the heat engine is a type of engine in which the chemical energy of the fuel is converted into the thermal energy. And this thermal energy is further utilized to produce the mechanical energy or the mechanical work. I hope you are understanding these basic fundamental concepts of the heat engine. I am making the concept to be as simple as possible, and also I am going somewhat in depth in order to justify my points, because it is one of the important chapters related to the exam point of view. So let me know your comments in the chat box if you have understood this basic concept of the heat engine. Kindly share your responses in the chat box so that I can proceed further with my discussion. Okay, thank you students for the positive responses from your side. Let us proceed further. So this is a simple schematic diagram for the heat engine. Dear friends, if you remember the second law of thermodynamics, in the second law of thermodynamics, we were having two statements, the Kelvin-Planck statement and the Clausius statement. So heat engines, they are the modifications of the Kelvin-Planck statement. So this is the practical application of the Kelvin-Planck statement. Let me revise the Kelvin-Planck statement once again so that you are perfectly understanding or getting the points. In the Kelvin-Planck statement, we have understood that it is impossible for a device operating in a cycle to produce net work by exchanging the heat from the single fixed temperature bodies. That means if I am not taking QC, I am not rejecting the heat QC, then I cannot develop a device which continuously takes the heat energy and produces the work. That means the 100% conversion of energy into work, that is not possible. So for getting the work at the output, compulsory we need to have some exchange of heat between the two bodies. And since the heat transfer automatically takes place from the hot body to the cold body, we are getting the work, This is automatically done by itself and the heat engine is operating in the cycle. But compulsory for getting the work, this QC must be there and it is very essential. If we are reducing the amount of QC, that is the losses, we can get more amount of work. If the losses are increasing, then we will be getting less amount of work. So now considering the schematic diagram, taking the notations T as we are considering temperature in Kelvin, Q, there is the correction, it is not degree Kelvin, always we need to consider Kelvin. So Q, that is the amount of heat which is considered in joules, W, that is work, also considered in joules. Small h represents the hot conditions and C represents the cold conditions. If we want to determine the efficiency of the heat engine, this is the standard relation, that is efficiency is equal to W upon QH. In simple terms, efficiency is output divided by input. So as we are seeing in the figure, the output of the heat engine, that is W, so W is mentioned, divided by input, the value which is entering the heat engine, that is QH. Now in order to calculate W, we will be taking the differences between QH and QC. So that is the amount of heat supplied from the hot reservoir minus the amount of heat rejected to the cold reservoir divided by Q. So I hope you have understood up till this point. Let me again inform you that heat engines are the modifications of the Kelvin Planck statement. Dear students, have you understood this point of the efficiency? Okay, fine. So let us proceed further. The types of the heat engines. Already we have studied the types of the heat engines in the classification of the prime movers. Once again, let us revise those points. So heat engines are mainly classified on the basis of the type of the combustion, or to be more specific, the location of the combustion of the fuel. So if the combustion of the fuel takes place outside the engine cylinder, then they are considered as the external combustion engines. And if the combustion of the fuel takes place inside the engine cylinder, they are considered as the internal combustion engines. Some of the examples of the EC engines, they can be considered as the steam engines, steam turbines. And some of the examples of the internal combustion engines, we are very good aware of it. Examples are the automobile engines which we are using in our bikes, trucks, cars, etc. So steam engines, they were used in the railways initially for the transportation purposes. If you remember, we were using the coal as the fuel in the railways, so that engine was considered as the steam engines. And in that engines, the combustion of the fuel was taking place outside the engine cylinder. So this is the simple classification of the heat engines. Dear students, if you understand the basic points of it, then you can perfectly understand the topics and you can perfectly write down the answers in the examination and can get the full marks out of your answers. Proceeding further, that is the comparison between the IC engines and the EC engines. Now the picture will be more clear to you related to both these engines. So first parameter I am considering for the comparison, that is the combustion of the fuel. So from the name only we can understand In the internal combustion engines, the combustion of the fuel takes place inside the engine cylinder, but in the external combustion engine, the combustion of the fuel takes place outside the engine cylinder. Next parameter, that is the type of the working fluid. So in the IC engines, we are using the working fluid as petrol, diesel or various types of gases. And in EC engines, we are considering the working fluid as the steam. Space requirements, the IC engines are compact in size, hence we are using in our standard automobiles, hence they require less space. But when we consider the EC engines, they are very bulky in size and hence they require comparatively larger spaces. Hence, the EC engines were used in the railways initially. Let us proceed further in the comparison. The fourth parameter, that is the capital cost. So, IC engines, the capital cost is relatively low as compared to the EC engines. EC engines are used today in major applications of the steam turbines. Also in the railways, which were initially working on the EC engines, they are used, but right now the application has reduced extensively, because in the EC engines, whenever they are operating, they are creating tremendous amount of pollution. Because in the EC engines, we are using the coal basically in the railways as the fuel. So on the combustion of the coal, if you understand, tremendous ash particles are being developed, and also it creates a good amount of the pollution. So right now the EC engines are used in the steam turbines for the generation of the powers in the major power sectors, and in some percentage of the railways for the transportation of the goods. For all the passenger vehicles of the railways, we are using the electrical concepts. Okay, roll number 51. I hope I have answered your question. Thank you for the response. Okay, roll number 61, I have seen your question, but just wait for some time. We are going to discuss this question in this chapter only. So let me cover all these points and I hope you will be automatically getting the answer of your question. Roll number 61, is it clear to you? Okay, fine. So let us proceed further with the comparison, that is starting of the engine. So IC engine, since they are smaller in size, they are easy to start and quick starting is taking place, as we have observed now in our automobiles. The button start are coming, so by pressing just a button, the engine is operated, no need to give the force on the kick. But in the EC engines, since they are having the larger dimensions, they are very bulky. Also, the coal must be required, they must be filled in the container, the combustion must be started. So, tremendous other things needs to be done for operating the EC engine. So, starting requires more time and also it is not easy. The last point of comparison, that is the power developed per unit weight. If we are considering the same weights of both these engines, that are the IC engines and the EC engines, then analysis have proved that the IC engines, they generate more amount of power. And the EC engines, they generate less power. So this is in context with some mechanical engineering terms. Several parameters, other parameters in context of the design, working, performance, all these points need to be considered. And on the conclusion of all these points, the sixth point is mentioned, that is the power developed per unit weight. In IC engines, the power developed is higher, but in EC engines, the power developed is low. So with this, I am completing the comparison between the IC engine and the EC engine. Dear students, are you getting the points? Are you understanding the topics which I am discussing? I want the responses from majority of the students, because always I get the responses from the same students. Okay, roll number 84, are you getting the points? Are you understanding? Please reply in the chat box. Roll number 84. Roll number 60. What is your comments? Are you getting all the points? Roll number 60. Okay, fine. So now let us proceed further with the next topic, that is the elements of the heat engine. Here, friends, this is somewhat a different figure which is given in your book, but I have considered a simple figure for the explanation purposes. In the book, you will be given the another name for the heat engine, that is the converting machine. But for understanding the logics, for understanding the concepts, I have taken a simple figure for the explanation. So heat engine, as you are seeing, that it will be consisting of a hot reservoir that will be taken at temperature TH, and you will be considering another reservoir that will be a cold reservoir. Dear students, reservoir can be considered as a system or a component. There are two reservoirs. One reservoir is at a higher temperature, so it is considered as a hot reservoir at temperature TH. The second reservoir is considered at a lower temperature, so it is considered as the cold reservoir and temperature is TH. Now, as we are aware that for the transfer of heat, we require some medium. The heat cannot directly transfer from hot reservoir to heat engine to the cold reservoir. Some medium must be provided. So that medium in the heat engine is one of the most important element, and that medium is known as the working substance or the working fluid. I am repeating the statement once again. For the transfer of heat from the hot reservoir to the cold reservoir, we require some medium. That medium in the heat engine is one of the most important element or the component, and that medium is known as the working substance or the working fluid. So by the movements of the working fluids from the hot reservoir to the heat engine to the cold reservoir, we are able to transfer the heat from the hot reservoir to the cold reservoir. And we are knowing that the heat transfer can take place perfectly or automatically from the hot reservoir to the cold reservoir. So in the heat engine, it will be taking the heat from the hot reservoir, using that heat energy and producing the mechanical work. So that is the output of our heat engine. And now whatever energy which is not converted into work, that must be rejected in the cold reservoir. And friends, remember, if the rejection of QL is less, then we will be getting more amount of work. And if the amount of QL is more, then we will be getting less amount of work, because this QL justifies the losses. And if we are reducing the losses, but obviously the performance will be increasing. And if the losses are increasing, then the performance will be decreasing. And in this case, we are considering the performance in terms of efficiency, that is work. And if you remember the previous equation of the efficiency, it was W upon QH. So let us understand the components. So hot reservoir, it supplies the heat to the engine. It is always maintained at a higher temperature. And that higher temperature, we are assuming it as TH. And hot reservoir in context of the heat engine, it is considered as the source. So kindly remember all these technical terminologies. The next component or the element, that is the working substance. Remember friends, we cannot observe the working substance because it is not a component, it is not an element. It is the medium which is flowing in the cycle of the heat engine. So working substance can be considered as a substance like a gas or the water, which converts the heat supplied into the work. The third important element, that is the cold reservoir, that is sink. The heat engine rejects some amount of heat QL into the cold reservoir after doing the work. And the cold reservoir must always be maintained at the lower temperature, that is TL. Have you understood this point? Kindly give me your responses in the chat box. Are you getting all the points? So that I can ask you one of the technical questions. I want the responses from majority of the students in the chat box if you have understood this point. Okay, fine. So let me ask you one of the technical questions. Dear students, understand this question perfectly and try to think over it. If the temperature of the sink is higher than the source, understand the example. If the temperature of the sink is higher than the temperature of the source, what will happen? I am repeating my question once again. Try to think over it. If the temperature of sink is higher than the temperature of the source, what will happen? Okay, 65 has answered me. Work cannot be done. Okay, 51 has given me the answer. Okay, cold reservoir. Okay, what are the other responses from other side, from other students? What are your comments on it? Okay, I am getting the mixed responses from this side. All the students are thinking in some other manner, but their technical perspective is right. Okay, so for better understanding, if the temperature of sink is higher than the source temperature, then the complete cycle of the heat engine will be reversed cycle. Have you got the point? Try to understand, if the temperature of the sink is higher than the source, then this will be the hot reservoir, this will be the cold reservoir. The heat transfer will be taking place from hot reservoir to the cold reservoir. So the direction of this heat transfer will be reversed. And now in this case, if I want to do the heat transfer, then I will not get the amount of work at the output. I need to supply the work to the engine. Have you understood the points which I have explained? Try to think in the technical perspective. I have only explained the technical aspects of it. These all points are not mentioned in your book. Just in order to clear the concept, I am just elaborating the terms, giving some practical examples and the technical description of it. Have you understood rule number 55, rule number 56, rule number 57? Kindly give me your responses in the chat box. Rule number 51, what is your take on it? Have you understood? Complete cycle will be reversed cycle. And now that reversed cycle will be the practical application of the Clausius statement. I am just elaborating my answer. Just think over it. If I am reversing this cycle from this point to the above point, and if I need to supply the work to the engine, I need to provide the work to the engine, then it is the application of the Clausius statement. Okay, so now I am getting the good responses. All are giving me the positive answers. Thank you all. So with this, I am completing this session from my side. Thank you for watching this session. Have a nice day. See you in the next lecture with some other points related to the heat engines. Now this session is open to you. If you are having any questions, you can ask me in the chat box. Okay, rule number 51, why do we require work if the sink is high temperature and source is low temperature? But I am not changing the positions of the sink and the source. Try to understand. In my actual figure, the source is at top side, the sink is at bottom side. So the heat transfer automatically flows. If I am considering the sink at the higher temperature, then I need to flow the heat in the reverse direction. So for making the heat transfer in the reverse direction. Okay, rule number 59, in reverse cycle, work is done on heat engine. Yes, if we want to reverse the heat transfer from sink to the source, then we need to provide the work to the engine. And some other elements are included in the heat engine cycle, that is the pump. A pump is provided in the heat engine cycle, which takes the working fluid from the sink and it transfers that working fluid to the source. And in the source, working fluid takes the energy and it is again transferred to the heat engine. So for running the pump, we need to provide some mechanical work, that is the input work.